Welcome, everybody. It's really great to see so many people here, and I'm very excited that we finally reached this conference, which we've had in the planning for several months now. When I was elected as an MEP, I wasn't entirely sure how much I'd be able to get away with, but this is one of the most exciting areas I'm working in, so we're just seeing how far we can push it. So far, we've had some questions to the boss of the central bank. Now we've got this conference, and we need to work out how we can go forward with what is such an obvious solution to some of our most serious economic problems. As I'm sure you know, the European Central Bank began its quantitative easing programme in January 2015, and it's pledged to continue with £60 billion a month of bond buying until at least March 2017, and possibly beyond that. And this is in the name of stimulating the Eurozone and strengthening the Euro's resilience against global shocks. But I don't need to tell you that it isn't actually being effective on either of those fronts. So I'm joined by some experts here today. I'll say a few introductory remarks, and then we're going to move on to a brief keynote by Frank van Lerven, who's a researcher at Positive Money and author of the report Recovery in the Eurozone, Using Money Creation to Stimulate the Real Economy. Then I'm going to pass over to Fran, who's sitting next to me here. Fran Boyt from Positive Money in London, and she's going to then introduce a panel discussion and introduce our other guests. So just in terms of an introduction to this session, I got interested in the idea of QE on the day, I think it was March the 9th, if I recall, 2009, when the British government began its quantitative easing programme. And that day, I was actually in Merthyr Tydfil, which is one of the poorest communities in Wales. And I was there for a conference about credit unions. And we were talking a lot about how very poor people were able to repay the debts they had incurred, or were not able to, but were always being forced to repay those debts. And at the very same time, we were seeing the Bank of England creating vast amounts of money to enable the banks to pay off the debts they had incurred through reckless lending. And the sort of coming together of those two issues on the same day kind of infuriated me, but also forced me down this path of really investigating how money's created and in whose benefit it's created, and really trying to challenge the existing system and put in place something better. So the British quantitative easing programme ran for 3 years and created £375 billion. But the Bank of England's own analysis concluded that this programme actually boosted the financial wealth of the top 5% of households rather than actually restoring the real economy. So it made the rich richer, it increased inequality, and it didn't deal with the key economic problems that we were facing. So what we need to do, instead of widening this gap between rich and poor, we need to close that gap, we need to invest in public services, and we need to have money to mitigate and deal with the issue of climate change. These possibilities are all there, I believe, if we challenge the way money's created and if we take power back over the money creation function in our economy. As I've said, I've made some steps down that road. I'm very glad to have my other colleagues who will be joining us for part of the session, Fabio De Masi and Paul Tang, also hosting this event. And I hope after this meeting we'll go forward together and we'll think about how we can continue to build interest in this issue and pressure for change in our role as MEPs here in the Parliament. So far, I've commissioned a report on Green QE called Green Money, which you can find just over here. Welcome, Fabio. Please join us. So it's called Reclaiming Quantitative Easing, and it's written for me by Victor Anderson, and you can find copies there, and please take them home or find that report online. I've also raised this question with ECB boss Mario Draghi, asking him whether he would consider a green bond buying programme for direct green investment, and actually the answer was kind of yes, which was a bit surprising, and I've also been in contact with officials from the Commission who are working on the investment plan, the Juncker investment plan called EFSI, to see whether we could find some way of using quantitatively eased money to provide that sort of public investment that's so necessary in our continent. So I'm delighted to welcome you here today. It's going to be a really interesting afternoon, and I'd also like to thank Fran and colleagues at Positive Money for co-hosting this event and for organising. I'd like to thank my office, especially Harriet, for putting in so much time on that front as well. So we're going to have an interesting afternoon. After that, I'd invite you to stay here because we're going to have a reception and more chance to network and over a glass of wine or a glass of juice or whatever's your poison. So that's all from me, and I'm now going to pass over to Frank, who's going to start with the introductory keynote.
So my name is Frank. I'm a researcher for Positive Money. If you see me doing this throughout the presentation, it's because I'm indicating to change slides. It's not quite working. I've been asked to basically give a very brief assessment of the ECB's quantitative easing program. Before cracking on, I thought it would be necessary to briefly just recap on what led to QE. At the core of the Eurozone's economic malaise essentially lies a crisis of spending. I just wanted to explain a bit more what I mean by this. A rapid increase in private sector borrowing was not only the primary cause of the 2008 financial crisis, but also really helps explain the intensity of the ensuing recession. Too much private debt and poor prospects for economic growth meant that the private sector has been sacrificing spending either to pay down old loans or to save for when economic conditions start to pick up. New regulations and oversized balance sheets meant that the banking sector was generally unwilling to expand its lending. So together, this resulted in less private sector spending and investment. After bailing out the banks, government social expenditures increased, such as unemployment benefits, while tax revenues declined, so you had a massive budget deficit increase as well. So soon after, governments began tightening their belts under the guise of austerity, and thus also restricted their spending. So basically what you've had is a massive restriction of spending from both the private sector and the public sector. The ECB eventually became concerned that spending would continue to decline, and the associated contraction in aggregate demand would jeopardize the ECB's primary mandate of price stability. The ECB accordingly decided to implement quantitative easing, or QE. QE is where central banks issue newly created central bank reserves and use them to buy pre-existing financial assets, mainly government bonds. So the ECB and the national central banks have basically colluded to will start purchasing up to 60 billion's worth of financial securities from the secondary market every month from now until, well, from last March until March 2017. The general aim of QE is to increase spending in order to achieve price stability, defined as 2% increase in inflation. So given the size and strategic importance of QE, I think it's important to review whether QE is producing its desired effect and whether the evidence really corresponds to the theory. On the surface of any assessment, we should look at inflation. After Draghi's announcement of the launch of QE, we can see that inflation first took off a bit and then it slowed. Inflation emerged again from negative territory in October after Draghi's announcement of expanding QE. But oil prices may still be distorting the effect of QE on inflation, so let's look a bit deeper at the transmission mechanisms through which QE is supposed to work. To begin with, I wanted to look at the expectations channel. Large-scale asset purchases give investors an idea about the future course of action that the central bank is going to take. Buying considerable amount of long-term securities shows the market that the central bank is committed to keeping interest rates low in the future. So as Mr. Draghi has, you know, repeatedly emphasized, anchoring expectations to a stable and private inflation, positive inflation rate is vital to the Eurozone's recovery, as Draghi says. So while inflation expectations experienced rapid increase in the wake of the announcement of QE, short-term and medium-term expectations are now where they were in late 2014, prior to the program's announcement, while longer-term market expectations recently also hit an all-time low. That's what the graph up there should be showing. Another channel through which QE is supposed to work is the portfolio rebalancing channel. You basically substitute bonds with cash, and therefore banks at that point will have more incentive to lend to the private sector, basically households and companies. A few points I just wanted to make here. Firstly, prices were increasing and yields were already extremely low before QE was even announced. So this isn't to say that QE didn't have a rebalancing effect. It's more that its rebalancing effect might have been limited. Secondly, it's very likely that portfolio rebalancing had its biggest impact at the announcement of QE, but has since faded. So, but most importantly, I wanted to mention that yields have been declining since 2012, while banks have been flooded with reserves through other policy programs. But we did not see an increase in spending or in investment due to through any portfolio balancing mechanism. So why should we see one now? This brings us to the next channel, the bank lending channel. Injecting new central bank reserves liquidity into the banking system relieves balance sheet constraints, allowing banks to increase their lending to the economy. Here we can see that there has been a bit of a negligible increase in bank lending. Conditions are slowly, let me emphasize, slowly improving. But what I really wanted to emphasize is that conditions have been improving for an extremely long time. If you look at up there, loan growth has actually been increasing since 2014. It was negative, but it's been slowly increasing. So also, when we look at lending for real economy spending, last month consumer lending increased by 1.4% and business lending actually declined by 0.55%. So, but the ECB also suggested that credit conditions have been better and they're gradually loosening and demand is increasing. But the fact still remains that real economy lending remains quite flat and it's well below what we need to see to trigger any increase in spending. So, and while the most recent ECB survey may suggest that a positive impact of QE on the real economy and that it has increased lending, a survey by Commerzbank completely contradicts this. The next transmission mechanism is the wealth channel. This suggests that higher asset prices also will essentially lead to an increase in demand as the wealthier get wealthier and they should be induced to spend more due to more disposable income. But firstly, wealthy asset owners have a very low marginal propensity to consume. But also the composition of financial markets in other places that have conducted QE is very different, especially in the US and in England. A much lower proportion of European households hold financial assets, and the value of those assets tends to be much lower in the Eurozone as well. So along these lines, I just wanted to note that consumption has hardly increased since the onset of QE, and any increase has to be taken in consideration with a reduction in oil prices. Meanwhile, investment has remained extremely subdued. So unsurprisingly, official data suggests that retail prices have been disappointing of late, and many people are suggesting that the Eurozone's industrial sector is actually in a recession. The fiscal channel. By pushing up sovereign bond prices, pulling down bond yields, QE lowers the interest rates that governments have to pay on their borrowing. But like I said before, we should note that borrowing costs were already extremely low when QE was announced. So what I should mention is that given recent global developments, borrowing costs may have been much higher had it not been for QE. Finally, I just wanted to mention the exports channel. By influencing yields and interest rates, QE devalues the currency, leading to an increase in exports. But let's remember that other central banks are conducting some form of monetary easing. Moreover, while exports may be cheaper, imports will also be more expensive. Here you can see that Eurozone net exports have only increased by about $3 billion in the last year. Finally, I just wanted to discuss the negative side effects of QE. By artificially increasing the price of financial assets, QE runs the risk of creating asset bubbles in the financial markets that could lead to further instability. Furthermore, QE increases inequality. I'm not really going to get into that, but we can discuss that later in question time. There's also a danger that monetary easing could keep up non-performing zombie so-called businesses afloat, which is maybe a very big danger in Italy at the moment. And finally, I just wanted to talk about the breaking up of smaller banks. The ECB notes that in 2014, the total number of credit institutions decreased to 5,614, down from 6,000 in 2013. So essentially, since 2008, there's been about a breakup of about 1,000 credit institutions. So what QE has really kind of benefited the bigger banks. Because they've managed to increase their profits, because they tend to hold more government bonds, and because they engage in more financial speculation. So they experience an increase in profits. Meanwhile, smaller banks don't really engage in any of financial speculation, so their profits have been reduced, and mainly because of regulation reforms, many small banks basically have had to basically default and close down. So while the point is there's also been a very devastating effect on QE for smaller banks that tend to lend to for real economy investment to small and medium businesses, especially in Germany. So to conclude, I wanted to remind everyone that QE is ultimately aimed at increasing spending by encouraging the private sector to take on more debt, so that the cause of the financial crisis is ultimately treated as the primary solution. I also hope that people will leave here today from this presentation asking themselves whether many of the conditions that QE tries to create were already in place when QE was announced. Finally, at best, QE has helped generate some sluggish results. We can always argue that things could be worse. But if we are restricted to considering that the counterfactual is the only benefit of QE, I think every policymaker needs to be asking themselves, is there a better way forward?
Thank you, Frank. And thank you, Molly, for your introduction. So I'm Fran from Positive Money, which is a researcher and campaigning organization focused on monetary policy and reforming the monetary system. And we are part of a coalition of 19 civil society organizations with a collective supporter base of over 100,000 people. And we think that there is a better alternative to the current quantitative easing program, which is why we are launching this campaign. With over 18 million people unemployed in the Eurozone and youth unemployment in Spain, Greece and Italy over 40%, then the Eurozone does not need quantitative easing for financial markets. It needs new money to be injected into the real economy to boost employment, increase spending, create jobs and improve the lives of ordinary people. A year ago, we coordinated a letter to the Financial Times, which was signed by 19 economists, which talked about better ways of boosting the Eurozone economy and employment. And it was signed by two of our speakers, and it outlined some proposals that you're going to hear about today. And now, a year later, we've got over 100, well, almost 100 economists supporting the campaign, and that number is growing. So under the umbrella of quantitative easing for the people are several different proposals. We didn't want the campaign to focus on one single approach because there are different economic arguments for different proposals. Instead, what we aim to do is to foster a public debate about quantitative easing for the people. And we aim to unite people around the principle that money created through quantitative easing should be spent into the real economy to benefit individuals and society as a whole. And this is why we're coming together to coordinate this campaign, and we are really, really pleased to bring it into the heart of the EU institutions, thanks to our supporting MEPs, Molly Scott-Cato, Fabio De Masi, and Paul Tang. So thank you very much. So just before I introduce the speakers, I just want to encourage you all to tweet about what you're hearing and interesting things. The hashtag is QE4People, with four as the number, not the word. And we are live streaming this, so hopefully there is a conversation happening online. After you've heard from the four speakers, I'm going to coordinate a question and answer, so I hope to hear from many of you. And then our supporting MEPs are going to close before we go downstairs for a reception. So we are really pleased to welcome these four speakers who are on the forefront of these ideas. First of all, we're going to hear from Professor Richard Werner, who is the Director for the Centre of Banking, Finance and Sustainable Development at the University of Southampton. Richard will speak on the proposal for strategic QE and talk about increasing spending on green infrastructure. Then we're going to hear from Eric Lonergan, who is a macro hedge fund manager, economist and writer. And Eric will speak about helicopter money, the citizens' dividend proposal. Then we get hear from Frédéric Boccara, who is a member of the French Economic, Social and Environmental Council and a member of l'Économiste Atterrés. Should have checked with that before. Frédéric will speak about the proposal for using QE for public investment. And finally, we're going to hear from Francis Coppola, who spent many years working for banks and now writes and speaks about banking, finance and economics. And Francis will speak about the barriers to implementing QE for people. So I'd like to hand over to our first speaker, Richard.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here. Thanks for the invitation, particularly thanks to Fran for organizing this and to Molly Scott-Cato for hosting this and for everyone else helping and participating. I'd like to talk about strategic QE. We did a study at the New Economics Foundation on this, which you can download off their website. And I'm going to give a bit more background and a bit more expansion in 10 minutes, so I have to be brief. The idea is, as we've really heard, very much in line with this, putting the monetary system, money and its creation, to better use. When did I get interested in QE? Well, it was actually in 1995 when I proposed it. This is the article in the Japanese Nikkei in September 1995 when I proposed to, after you know, a bust banking system type of recession, it's possible to get out of this recession if you create money for GDP transactions. So the original definition of QE is actually money creation for transactions contributing to GDP. Central banks have made a bit of a hash out of it, but that's not really surprising. It was also clear already at the time in the early 90s that lowering interest rates wouldn't work, fiscal stimulation that is not backed by bank credit creation, but bond issuance would not help, and just expanding bank reserves, the sort of thing they've been doing, which is an old thing, old monetarist policy, has failed very much in the past and clearly was not going to work again. So very briefly, who creates and allocates the money supply that we'd like to put to better use to? And conducted a survey actually around Frankfurt with the help of students from Frankfurt University, over 1,000 respondents. The question was, who do you think creates and allocates the majority of the money supply? And the survey result is that over 84%, this is slightly slid, is only the first two items, government and the central bank. So 84% thought the government or the central bank creates the money supply, which is fair enough. This is what common sense indicates. This is what it should be. But of course, the correct answer is the banks. It's all slipped a little bit, but I think many of you may know this. So if you go to the next slide. This is the trade secret of banking, what makes banks unique. If you borrow £1,000 or £1 million, as the case may be, whether you're a hedge fund or a private individual, what the bank does is it purchases the loan contract because it's a promissory note and puts it on the asset side of its balance sheet, which therefore lengthens. Of course, the bank, according to the same loan contract, also has to pay out money, which is a liability, and now it simply records its accounts payable liability arising from the loan contract as a fictitious customer deposit, which is not really correct, but that's what they do. Because the borrower clearly hasn't deposited this, and neither has the bank, nor has anyone else. So this is how the money supply is created out of nothing by the banking system. It's not transferred from anywhere else. Nobody has, the bank certainly hasn't given up anything. Which is, of course, why the justifications for usury charging interest go out of the window. As a consequence, of course, banks are very special. They have a very unique position in the economy. They create the money supply. unlike non-bank financial institutions, they can do this. Everyone else, even the other financial institutions that do similar things, if they don't have a banking license, they can't create money. And that is credit creation. This is how 97% of the money supply is created. And banks make this decision. So we have allocators out there that constantly decide how much money should be created, who should be the money given to, and for what purpose. Unfortunately, that's not coordinated in any sensible fashion, and you know the outcome of that. Now, you can simply divide the money streams into, or credit rather, because that's where it comes from. The C stands for credit, into two streams, credit for the real economy and credit for asset markets. So when the banks create money for transactions that contribute to GDP, such as investment or consumption, you'll notice in nominal GDP. But more often than not, and we had a lot of that in the last years leading up to 2008, money creation for asset markets, of course, pushes up asset prices. So you have basically three scenarios. Only one of them is sustainable, and that's the green box. If bank credit goes into non-GDP transactions, asset transactions, you create an asset bubble, always unsustainable, it's a Ponzi scheme. It only works while banks keep creating more money, injecting into financial markets. Once that game stops, game of musical chairs, there aren't enough chairs, bankruptcies, and the banking system itself will be bust. But if bank credit goes into GDP transactions, there's still two possibilities. Consumption, that's easily understood, can lead to consumer price inflation because you create more money, but there aren't any more goods. But if it goes into investment, then we have money creation and also the creation of more goods and services, implementation of new technologies, and, of course, properly defined productive means sustainable investment. It's also environmentally sustainable. We can, therefore, create money for these positive purposes without inflation and without negative consequences, and even when the economy is at so-called full employment. I'm just going to whiz through the following charts because of time limitations. There's a lot of data work behind this, but can show how you can test for this in various countries. You explain GDP with credit for GDP transactions. You explain asset prices with credit for financial transactions. Whenever the financial credit rises as a share of total credit and expands, you get this asset bubble like in the US in the 20s, Japan in the 80s, and of course in the run-up to the crisis in many countries, including, this is Japan, so too much credit when it exceeds GDP growth, you get this bubble and bust banking system. Then many examples, Ireland, Spain, Greece, where we had 30-40% credit growth, it wasn't really difficult to forecast what was going to happen next. The ECB should certainly have known. But not all countries were affected, because it's especially when you have a concentrated banking system with many large banks, then they don't want to lend to small firms, which are a bit more productive. They lend rather to the big speculators. So Germany did reasonably well. You didn't have in the 2000s this excess credit because the majority of the banking system is the two green parts of this pie. 70% of banking is not-for-profit community banking, and that in the past has been more productive and less speculative. Now, central banks have not created money for the public good for several decades, and that's what we need to introduce. They've bailed out banks. Taxpayers have had to come up for this, but they haven't really done much for the economy. The mortgage borrowers, they haven't been bailed out. So strategic QE is about creating money for positive purposes, such as renewable energy, sustainable industries and sustainable energy, infrastructure, green infrastructure in particular, education, R&D, the people in general. If you look at growth, what constitutes growth, a lot of empirical studies have shown 90 to 95% of growth is due to technology. And technology is created by R&D and education of people. So the single most important thing you need is people, which fits very much into our theme today. And there is a fundamental problem. Fertility rates have been collapsing across the world, as you know. But you can do something about it. Russia pays out a lot of money since 2006 for new babies, and the baby bonus has dramatically changed the fertility rate and has raised it. Australia has done the same thing and massively increased fertility. So we can create money, pay it out for babies, and we solve the demographic problem, which is a massive problem for society. And this can be done in a number of ways. And this is my last slide. It's not inflationary. It's linked to growth because the source of growth is people. They're the most productive thing in the economy. So instead of spending $500 billion on immigrants, as Germany is doing, the Bundesbank can use its secret, but now slightly becoming less secret, liquidity quota to issue baby bonus euros, 100,000 euros per baby. It will be far cheaper than what's currently going on. And you create a very sustainable economy together with QE for green, renewable energy and industries. And there's much more to say, But I'm out of time. You can read up and perhaps be in touch. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Listening to Richard, I'm reminded of the joke that you can't change demography overnight, although perhaps in this instance, actually, you can. My name is Eric Lonergan. I'm a fund manager and economist, but I am here as a citizen, a concerned citizen, and hopefully an informed citizen. You can be a judge of the latter. Firstly, I would like to thank everybody for inviting me here to speak. I feel very privileged, and also for everybody, thank you to all of you for attending to listen to this. There are only so many presentations in succession on economics. It is reasonable to expect anyone to listen to. At least they're going to be restricted to supposedly to less than 10 minutes. So what I would like to describe today is a very simple policy which is a number of very, very important characteristics. The first thing I want to say straight away is that virtually no serious economist denies that this policy would work. Okay? So we have a wealth of empirical evidence that this policy works. And when I say works, I mean it raises demand, it raises spending. And that is the main macroeconomic problem that the Eurozone currently faces, which is Mario Draghi, Jackson Hole, a year or so ago, made this very clear, that the problem in Europe is insufficient spending. We need more investment spending, we need more consumer spending, because in simple terms, the European economy is able to produce more than it is currently spending. Right? And that is causing an unemployment rate that is too high and an inflation rate that is too low, threatening the risk of deflation. And a high unemployment rate and deflation carries huge social and economic costs. And I want to reiterate what Frank was saying earlier, which is, yes, there is an economic recovery occurring, but there's two key points. We could do an awful lot better than this. It is way too slow, and slow growth has huge economic costs. And secondly, equally important, there is no contingency plan. Right? That is the truth. Okay, if there's a renewed recession in the Eurozone, there is no current policy that can bring that recession to an end quickly and that can plausibly counteract that recession. Right? More QE, more negative interest rates, a failing fiscal regime. There is simply no contingency plan. We need a contingency plan. So what I would like to do is, first of all, outline this policy. I'm then going to explain briefly why I think it's necessary. I then want to contrast it and explain why it is very clearly superior to both the fiscal choices we have today, but also to the current monetary regime. And finally, I will conclude by arguing that it's not just a legal policy, it's arguably a legal obligation of the European Central Bank. So I believe this policy is both entirely consistent with the legal mandate of the ECB, and because it has the highest probability of returning the Eurozone to price stability, it is in fact an obligation of the policy authorities. Okay, so let's deal with the first issue. What am I actually proposing? So the proposal is very simple. In order to meet its objective of price stability, which was defined by the ECB under the intellectual guidance of Ottmar Issing as being an inflation rate at close to 2%. In order to meet that mandate, I think the highest probability of success is that the European Central Bank would make transfers directly to the bank accounts of households within the Eurozone. Now, there are a number of ways this could be done, which is something we can discuss in the Q&A. It could be done through the banking system through a form of a loan structure, but the essential point is that the ECB should make cash transfers directly to households, and households would make the spending decisions as to what is done with those cash transfers. To put some sense of what order of magnitude we're discussing, in order to close the output gap, which is the difference between how much Europe can produce and how much Europe is currently producing, it is plausible that we would need to transfer something like 2 to 5% of GDP, which would be equivalent to something like 600 to 1,500 euros per capita. That's the order of magnitude that we're talking about. Now, I want to be very clear that although this is an innovation in monetary policy, it is not an innovation in conventional economics. This is a very, very straightforward, well-rehearsed, and well-established economic policy. In the United States, there have been multiple occasions in the last 20 years when the federal government effectively has made direct transfers to households, and all of the empirical evidence shows that that stimulates demand. It boosts spending. It is absolutely the case that some of it will be saved, and that's no bad thing. I think that's one of the attractions of this policy, is that households themselves will decide what is optimal to do with the money that they receive. The key point, however, is that it unambiguously raises demand. It addresses directly the problem that we face. Now, it's worth preempting a number of typical objections to this. The first is often that people are concerned about the central bank getting involved in transfers, fiscal effects, redistribution effects. Well, the first point to bear in mind is that all of the current conventional policies have fiscal effects and involve transfers. Okay, so again, we can come back and discuss these, and I'm sure other speakers will address these issues. But if you look at QE and negative interest rates, it is effectively a transfer from the financial sector to the government sector, right? So there is a direct impact of negative interest rates and combined with QE on the fiscal positions of governments in the Eurozone. Every time interest rates are changed, there is a transfer within the economy, right? From one group, savers to borrowers is the typical way it is described, but it's also a transfer in lots of other ways. So all monetary policy transactions, all economic activities involve transfers and involve fiscal consequences. In fact, the attraction here of this policy is it is entirely fair. Okay? It discriminates against no interest group. It's not saying I'm going to favor borrowers, lenders, old people, young people. It is treating everybody equally and saying that all European citizens should benefit in the same way from a monetary stimulus, should benefit equally from monetary stimulus. And not only that, we will not try and force them to do something that they don't want to do, which is essentially what policies are currently trying to achieve. We will allow them to decide how they want to spend the money. Okay, so that is the principle of how it would work. Why is it necessary? The main reason why it's necessary, if we could just show the, on this slide here. The main reasons why it's necessary is multiple. First of all, the effects of current policies are highly uncertain and speculative. There is no serious contingency plan. Negative interest rates in particular, we have no precedent and no evidence that they're effective. By contrast, cash payments to households is very well understood, is recognized by all spectrums in economics. Milton Friedman in 1968 recommended this as a policy response to zero interest rates, a liquidity trap. Gottfried Haberler, the Austrian economist, recommended it. It's a Keynesian policy Ben Bernanke has recommended. The empirical evidence we have from the states shows that it is very clear. And as I have already said, it is fair and discriminates against no part of the economy. Okay, now how can we compare and contrast this to conventional or current fiscal and monetary policies? Well, if we look at the nature of current fiscal and monetary policy, there's a very clear set of pros and cons. Right? The advantages of fiscal policy is that they impact spending directly, which is precisely what Richard was describing. Also, fiscal policy can be used to support other objectives, such as infrastructure spending. The problem we have, however, is there's no consensus on fiscal policy. It's not timely. It doesn't impact the economy next week. There are huge lags. It involves planning. It's difficult to coordinate, and there are vested interests that oppose it. Now, monetary policy has almost the opposite pros and the opposite cons. Monetary policy can be done, a conference call can be called right now by Mario Draghi, and the ECB can decide to cut interest rates. The problem is it doesn't impact spending directly. It requires interference through the financial system, which, as we've already heard outlined, is extremely problematic, and it works indirectly. Okay, so cash payments direct from the ECB to households is superior to both of those options because it does impact spending directly. It can happen extremely quickly, and it is fair and equivalent to all. Okay, I want to move forward a couple of slides to the issue of the legal obligations of the ECB. If you read all of the legal statutes that relate to the ECB, there are really three main overriding principles. The first one is that its legal objective is to generate price stability. The second one is that it has to be independent. And the third is that it cannot finance the government. Those are the three overriding legal principles. Oops. Now, this policy directly deals with each one of those. The ECB remains independent. It is not financing fiscal activity, so it requires no coordination with the Treasury, and it is actually a prerequisite for the ECB to meet its objectives of price stability.
So thank you for inviting me, for organizers also. And we share the idea that the use of money is a must become a popular issue. So first, please stand. A quantitative easing really for people is a decisive point for European economy and for people. Why? Because Europe is on the edge of a deflation or recession, and on a new and more terrible financial crisis. So more money is needed by monetary creation, because money creation means what? It means new inflow of money beyond the existing given production or the existing stock of wealth. This new money is needed for doing two things. On one side, stimulating demand side, and also, on the other side, developing supply side, a new production. And indeed, we need new production for people's needs, new kind of production for ecology and jobs, and more production. For example, houses, constructions, public services as education, manufacturing, pharmaceutical, etc. And for new production, we need advances, monetary advances, because before to produce, we didn't have produced. Two examples, we need training and education before to produce. Or we need investment or R&D, research and development, before to produce. That is why we need more money, monetary creation. We have, so in front of us, that monetary creation through quantitative easing by European Central Bank. 1.5 billion of new euro. Two, the existing quantitative easing is fueling speculation. Actually, now, quantitative easing means that European Central Bank uses its monetary creation to buy existing paper, I mean to buy securities and bonds. What that means? It means that the European Central Bank gives money to those owners behind the securities, and let them doing whatever they want with the money. And in fact, you show it, they, the owners, are financial markets, and they seek only profits, short-term profits, more profits, profit against value-added, profit against jobs, profit against equity and equality, and even profit against efficiency. And what do we observe? More speculation on stock markets, on raw materials, outflow of capital from Europe, and also the location of jobs, the localization, we say in France. One figure, the total net outflow of capital during the last 2 months is November 14 until November 15, is 250 billion euro outflow from Europe. And jobs, we don't know, they don't count. So we need another quantitative easing. Third, what is the logic of another quantitative easing and the aim? Supporting people development and qualification, and supporting good production ecological production with good jobs. This is real economic efficiency because, first, value-added aim will secure the monetary creation, because by aiming value-added, we ensure that in front, as a counterpart of the money, we will have production. So no inflation in stock market, so-called bubbles. Second, because people development, their skills, their training, their good life, is now becoming more and more the determine the key point of efficiency and of production efficiency, indeed, with the exigencies of the informational technologies, the new informational revolution. And, of course, it is also socially efficient because it will reduce inequality, increasing disposable income for people and jobs. So, four, how doing it? We need to walk on our two complementary legs, public services and businesses. Why? Why public services? Because public services, it immediately boosts demands. Public services, it is mainly not investment in infrastructure, but it is spending for wages, mainly teachers and nurses and a lot of other people, but wages, so it boosts demands first, and simultaneously, it develops the potential of supply, because this potential of supply residing in human capabilities, education, training, research, etc. The second leg is businesses, of course, because they are at the heart of production, innovation. They produce 2/3 of the value added, of the GDP, if you prefer, and they employ more or less the same share of people. So we have to see the existing levies of financial markets on those two legs. I take only two examples. On public services, the example of France, and in all countries I think it is the same, yearly interest paid to financial market, not the principal but only interest rate, represents 44 billion. It represents one yearly budget of national education by years paid to the financial market by France. Italy is the same. England, Germany, I think it is more or less the same everywhere. On businesses, I have a euro figure, eurozone, dividend plus interest paid represent 2,000 billion euro a year compared to social security contributions by businesses, which is less, which is only 1.8 billion euro, 1,000 billion euro. So I will sketch now two means. First, creating, a European new fund for common ecological and social development, a new fund. The fund, follow me, the fund will be between national states and central bank. The fund between those will buy public bonds of national states if the public bonds finance development of public services and jobs. And it will buy it at near zero interest rate. For that, the fund will receive and use a part of the monetary creation by the European Central Bank at zero interest rate to buy the bonds. And the fund will keep the bonds, not making them circulating in the financial markets, out of the speculation hands. And we create the fund so we can put, at the beginning, a new governance democratic on the fund. Members of European parliaments, several members of national parliaments, to make the joint between Europe and nations, representatives of unions, and even we can propose for people a possibility from the territory to submit public services projects to the fund. The existing European treaties authorize it. Yet, all people know that European Central Bank is forbidden to buy public bonds to states. It's the Article 123.1 of the Lisbon Treaty. But the next article, 123.2, authorizes a public financial institution to do it. And the fund will be that public financial institution. So I propose to say, new created euro, the money of European people, must develop public services all around Europe, schools, university research, etc. It is allowed by the treaties. So what it is not done? And second and finally, businesses. Fostering businesses' development of job and value-added, good production, with specific criteria and not speculation by businesses. How? By the European Central Bank action on banks to push them, the banks, developing a new credit, a new selectivity. What is the channel? The refinancing of the banks by European Central Bank. We need targeting the refinancing of credit banking by the European Central Bank. European Central Bank, we use another part of its monetary creation to refinance credit of banks if and only if those credits correspond to investment supporting good value-added, more production, but good production, more jobs, and good jobs, and at low interest rates. The more the jobs are created, the more their quality, and the more the interest rates will be reduced. And European Central Bank would not refinance speculation. So that would secure both economy and people, and even the banks themselves. To sum up briefly, it is money for people and their development through new European fund and another refinancing of banks by European Central Banks. Thank you all.
You'll be relieved to know that I'm not going to use slides. I'm just going to talk. And I think I slightly drew the short straw here because I'm here to talk about the obstacles to these wonderful ideas presented by Richard and by Frédéric and by Eric and, of course, by Frank. Because it's easy to come up with lots of ideas about how the ECB could reflate the Eurozone and indeed the EU. We should remember that countries outside the Eurozone also have high unemployment. I'm thinking, for example, of Slovakia. It's easy to come up with ideas, but then we face obstacles in getting them accepted. And there are questions about if it's all so easy, why we haven't done it. And so I want to talk about a few of the obstacles. The first and primary obstacle, it seems to me, is a general perception that people shouldn't get something for nothing. That if we simply give people money, they will do something irresponsible with it, they won't use it properly, and we will be in a dreadful mess. I think it's immensely difficult to get across the idea that when everything's falling apart, when you've got very high unemployment, when your economy is on the floor, that actually just giving people money can be a way out of the problem. That is almost like a popular change that needs to happen, a mindset that needs to change. And I'm not sure how we do that, but if we could present that today as being the idea that just giving people some money and enabling them to spend it could actually help to regenerate some activity, some much-needed GDP growth across Europe. So that's the first obstacle, is this kind of mindset that says you've got to earn your money. You can't just have it for nothing. There is a second issue as well, which was running through my head all the time I was hearing my colleagues speaking, which is the question of the ECB's mandate. The ECB's mandate is price stability, which currently is defined as being inflation below but close to 2%. It's some way off that at the moment. There is a question about whether the ECB's mandate should be symmetrical or asymmetrical. It seems to be somewhat asymmetrical at the moment in that it doesn't seem that bothered about being below target. But back in 2011, when it was going above target, boy, did it slam on the brakes quick. So I want to see how we can look at these proposals in the light of the ECB's single mandate. It seems to me the ECB is not meeting its mandate. At the moment, it is some distance below it in terms of inflation. Therefore, we should be doing whatever it takes, to use Draghi's words, to raise inflation. One of the principal obstacles often cited as objections to, particularly to the citizens' dividend, to helicopter money, is that it would raise inflation. Good. Then they say, but then when we've got inflation up again, how do we stop it overshooting? I think the kind of transfer that Eric was talking about is not really going to cause a major overshoot. But if it did by any chance, then the ECB still has ordinary monetary operations at its disposal. It is awash with assets that it could sell. And if, as a last resort, it could even issue its own bonds. The idea that having issued money directly to the real economy, you can't call it back again, is simply wrong. You can raise interest rates. That's what they're for. So I rather quickly dismiss the monetary objections to this. I'm going to quite quickly dismiss some of the economic objections as well. One of the things that we often hear say is, if you give people money, it will be a disincentive for them to work. Again, we're not talking about huge amounts of money here. I am, of course, speaking about the citizens' dividend at the moment. I'll come back to the investment programme in a minute. Only if we kept on doing it might it be a disincentive to work, because it would then turn into some kind of universal basic income, and we would then be discussing what would be an appropriate level to support demand, to support people's incomes so that they can't crash down to zero income and starve, but would still incentivise them working. That's a separate discussion and one that we may wish to have at some point. But at the moment, we're talking about one-off stimulus to improve demand in a downturn. The other objection to that kind of approach is what we call the Ricardian equivalence problem, which is that if people know it's temporary, they'll just save it, won't they? Because it's going to be withdrawn again and then they'll have to pay it back. I think this rather depends upon people's circumstances. And when you have people, when you have a payment that is going across the board to lots of people, irrespective of their circumstances, you might well expect that people who are a little bit better off might indeed do that. But they might also use it to pay down debt, which is no bad thing. But poorer people who are struggling to survive would be likely to spend the money. And so there would be some stimulus in the economy, even if there were Ricardian effects. I don't really think the Ricardian equivalence argument is a sufficient argument to oppose a citizen's dividend. It might increase imports. Right now in the Eurozone, there is a trade surplus. I think we have room to accommodate some extra imports. And again, it would help to stimulate things generally. And even if people did save it, we could argue that saving can be directed towards productive investment anyway. So is it such a big deal if they save it? So there are a number of obstacles there. There are fiscal objections as well. If a fiscal is currently undergoing consolidation, and monetary financing is used by households to pay their taxes or to replace benefits that have been cut, it could be argued that it's indirect monetary financing of governments. Frankly, I think this is a rather thin argument given the monetary financing governments that Eric outlined just now with LTROs and QE. So if we can say that that's okay, then I think we can say that the other sort is okay as well. And there are, of course, practical difficulties concerned with how on earth, with a citizen's dividend, we reach everybody. Not everybody has a bank account. People are on the move. Governments are notoriously bad at keeping records of where their citizens are. So it may well be that there are some people who will simply lose out. Is that a major obstacle? I think not. I mean, obviously, there are fairness issues there. But if, given that we're talking about monetary stimulus here, I don't regard that as an insurmountable obstacle. Now, I want to talk briefly about the other sort of financing, which is investment. We are partway down that route already with President Juncker's plan, because that involves the European Investment Bank issuing bonds, which could, of course, be bought by the ECB as part of a conventional QE programme. which would arguably be monetary financing of investment across the whole of the EU. I don't think anybody would have any serious objections to it all, least of all the ECB. So I think there's a little bit of a half-open door there. Where I think we may run aground on that one is the idea that the EIB might actually issue bonds specifically for the ECB to buy. If the UK, say, tried to do that, it has been suggested, we would run into real issues with monetary financing of governments. But I think at this point, the incomplete nature of the European Union, or the Eurozone in particular, kind of plays into our hands a bit. We do have separation of the monetary infrastructure from the fiscal infrastructure in Europe. We have individual fiscals, and we have an overarching monetary authority, and we don't at the moment have an equivalent federal authority. So it could be argued that if the ECB chose to monetize bonds issued by the EIB for the purposes of investment across Europe as a whole, is that really monetary financing of governments? I think not. So again, sometimes things that don't work quite well kind of play into our hands. I completely agree with Frederick's argument that money used in that way would indeed, over the medium term, generate jobs, increase productivity, improve technology. It would indeed bring supply-side stimulus to Europe, much, much needed. No doubt that would be good. There is a timing problem here, that monetary stimulus is supposed to be short-term, but if we're using it to fund long-term investment, what happens when we need to withdraw it? Do we expect the capital markets to pick it up? Are we suddenly going to down tools? What are we going to do? We need to think about exit strategies if we use it in that way. And there is also the question that, in a way, we're not talking about incompatible things here. We're not talking about either or. We are talking about long-term supply-side stimulus to do with increasing production, infrastructure improvements, improving employment, and we're talking about short-term monetary stimulus to improve demand. I don't see those as incompatible, and it seems to me that with different hats on, the ECB could undertake both of them, and I completely agree with Eric's point that given that it's not meeting its price stability mandate at the moment, the citizens' dividend at any rate is a bare minimum that it should be doing. Thank you all.
Thank you, Francis, and thanks to all our speakers. We made it through, so now we're moving on to Q&A, and as the chair, I'm going to take the privilege of asking the panelists a few questions whilst you think of some that you'd like to ask. Unfortunately, Richard has had to dash off back to the UK. He flew in from Moscow this morning, so he's already departed, and Frederick is also going to have to depart soon. So if you want to get specific questions for our panelists, I'm afraid we're down to three plus these MEPs who will also be willing to answer questions, I'm sure. So to kick off with you, Frederick, on Monday at the Monetary Dialogue, Mario Draghi, who's the governor of the ECB, talked about the need for fiscal expansion in the Eurozone countries. But he did acknowledge that could only happen in countries like Germany because of their political agreements such as the Stability and Growth Pact. But it seems that the ECB is acknowledging there needs to be some kind of economic stimulus, but it doesn't want to acknowledge that monetary policy could play a role in that stimulus. So do you have any thoughts on that conversation and where it could go?
Thank you, Fran, for your question. And so I make my point clearer. So why monetary stimulation and not only fiscal stimulation? And you see, Mario Draghi said only Germany has to make fiscal stimulation because they have a surplus. For him, it's not a question of need, it's a question of surplus. And you see, we need money because in the countries where we are need to develop stimulation, the production is not sufficient. So we need money to go beyond the first step and then to compensate it with production and the second step. So we have to stimulate in all the countries, Greece, France, Italy, Netherlands, all the Eurozone and also all the Europe, Poland, UK, etc. So reserve it to Germany, it's a false idea. But he recognized this, that we need simulation and that we need public spending, even in Germany. But he didn't say it also public spending in public services, out from the short-term seeking of profit, but we need long-term spending. So why monetary, not fiscal? Because we want to not be bounded by the existing limited growth and to stimulate all the Europe.
Thank you. Does anyone else have a question for Frédéric while he's here before he rushes off? I'll just open it to the floor. And if not, I'll move on. Okay. Have I missed one? Okay, yeah, Simon in the purple shirt.
Question for Francis.
Oh, sorry, I was just taking questions for Frédéric right now because he's leaving in 2 minutes. No? Does anyone have a question specifically for Jen?
Yeah, it's a more slightly more general question than using the public purse, as it were, to stimulate demand. The reason we're talking about quantitative easing, that it's possible to do, is fundamentally because there's an imbalance between incomes and productivity. And my question is about wages and how to increase wages across Europe to do it in a balanced way so that the high productivity countries in Northern Europe do better. For example, in rural France, where you're from, the one-third of income that people can pay on rent is about half the actual economic cost of providing. So what can we do to increase wages alongside this, or how does quantitative easing help to increase wages?
I answer briefly, and Fran showed me that I may miss my train, so I will roughly answer. First, putting money more on wages, training, and public services is increasing wages. But second, we have labor costs, but also capital costs. So I explain, putting money at low cost, low interest cost, so lowering capital costs, not only on one dimension, lowering capital costs to increase labor costs, but also to make new spendings, so new spendings of efficiency, and so all the costs will diminish. Even if you pay more wages, the production and efficiency is more, so the cost of the wages in proportion will be less, but people will have more. Do you understand? So lowering capital costs to develop new spendings, wages, training, and new investment to develop efficiency. That is the logic. I cannot enter in the detail, and I want to thank you again.
Thanks for coming.
Goodbye.
Francis, if I can ask you about, so evidence from the US and UK quantitative easing programs is that it's done very little to boost demand and has had negative consequences such as inequality, increased inequality, which Molly mentioned earlier. And as Frank discussed, the kind of economic conditions that QE is supposed to produce were already there in the Eurozone before it started last March. So why was there no discussion in terms of doing QE differently? Why did they do it the same anyway?
I think sometimes economists are creatures of habit. I think it's not entirely true to say that QE in the UK and the US had no effect. I think it did. How much effect it had, we don't know. We do know that it had unfortunate consequences because it did increase wealth inequality. But I think it's possibly unfair to say, given that the UK and the US are some of the best performing in the economies of the world right now, to say that it had no effect. And I imagine that what's happened is that there's been quite a good sales job, particularly by market monetarists, say QE is wonderful, you need to do lots of it, the ECB really, really, really needs to do QE. This went on for years, I think, didn't it? This sales job. It's widely bought by financial markets. The ECB kept talking about it and kept saying, yeah, we know how to do it, we've got all the tools in place, we've dealt with all the legal problems, and you know, yeah, we can do it, we can do it. And in the end, I think markets just said to the market, go and do it then, because otherwise we don't believe you. And in the end, I remember writing about this at the time, saying the ECB appeared to have painted itself into a corner with forward guidance, and ended up having to do QE because otherwise it was going to be a ruckus on the financial markets. Not the greatest argument for doing it, I would say, and I'm not entirely sure that it's been that good a move myself.
Thank you. So if I can move to Eric. So we've heard kind of privately from ECB officials that both that helicopter is possible under the current legal framework, but also that the ECB wouldn't ever undertake some kind of helicopter money unless member states directed it to do so. What are your thoughts on the next necessary steps to get this proposal considered by the ECB?
I'm skeptical of that assumption. Right. So I think this one needs to be very clear about two different sets of policies here. One is about government spending by national treasuries on infrastructure, or even through the EIB, European-wide spending. I think that's inherently problematic for the ECB to be directly involved in coordinating or in effectively creating money for that directed purposes. I also think it's not obviously necessary, because the point is that governments can borrow at negative interest rates in nominal terms, at negative interest rates in real terms, so they should be doing infrastructure spending anyway, which begs the obvious question. Something within the European institutional system is stopping them from doing so. Right? Now, that means, so I actually think we should put that one aside. If we want to do infrastructure spending, let's get on with it, because it's costing us nothing. Now, it's actually we're being paid to do infrastructure. But there's a key point. Does that mean the ECB can't do anything? Absolutely not. The ECB can make LTROs to households intermediated through the banking system. It's a continuation of their existing policies. But in contrast to their existing policies, it doesn't depend on asset price distortion. It doesn't depend on negative interest rates, which have very perverse, uncharted consequences for the economic system. It has proven benefits, if we look at all the empirical work on transfer payments, and it's entirely legal. So I don't see. So having said that, there is an administrative challenge which one shouldn't understate. I think it would make absolute sense for the ECB to say, in order to meet our mandate, we want to have this at a minimum as a contingency. Even if we don't plan to do it, we need a contingency, because today we have no contingency. And so we would like to get prior approval by the Council or by the European Parliament. But I think it should be made very clear that it's entirely legal. If you look at Article 20 of the protocol, which is attached to the treaty, the ECB has complete flexibility as long as it is pursuing its objective of price stability, and as long as it's operating independently, and the policy I'm describing is entirely independent. No national treasury is involved, no taxation is involved, no governments need to be involved, right? The ECB does it directly through the banks to households. So it's legal, indeed I would say it's a legal obligation. I just, if I could, you know, the thing I think here is really key is Europe has to show leadership and innovation. And Europe, do you know what's going to happen? The most depressing thing is another country will do this and we'll copy them afterwards, having waited for 2 or 3 years and wasted economic, social and human resources. That is an absolute disgrace. There's an opportunity here. Actually, the legal system in Europe is better placed to do this than in the United States. But we're going to wait for somebody else to do it. We shouldn't. We should show leadership. We should innovate. This is legal. It works. Let's get on with it.
And just quickly on that. So, I mean, if it is legal, who's the kind of first signal should come from? Should it be
the governing council? The governing council has an obligation. I've had meetings with. I don't think this has been considered seriously. I think helicopter money has been explored in a very poor way. They need to devote proper resources. France has outlined there's a range of forms of helicopter money. We have described, there's many economists who have been involved in this process, including myself and Francis. We have described a way in which it is legal and effective. That is actually not what Mario Draghi is addressing. He needs to be asked directly, if you do TLTROs directly to households at an infinite duration with no interest rate intermediated through the banks, it's your legal obligation to do that in order to meet your mandate of price stability. Whenever I've asked them a question along those lines, I have not received an answer, which either means they don't want to tell us the answer or they haven't considered it in detail. I suspect it's both are true.
Thank you. Okay, so just moving on to the infrastructure proposal, because I wanted to bring Molly in because she commissioned a report on green infrastructure. And I think that, you know, if QE money was to be spent on that, then there is clearly an overlap with fiscal policy. And what institutional arrangements could you see working between the ECB and member states? Would it be just a case of financing EIB bonds, or is there more, you know, does it need to be more complex than that?
Well, I think, I mean, basically what Francis said is the same thing we have in the report there, that we use the FC programme when we get the EIB to issue bonds, which are then bought by the ECB. I think that's fairly straightforward. And we had somebody from Catalonia's cabinet here when we launched that report, and he was basically seemed pretty much up for that. So I think that's kind of proposal that we could take forward and meet with some success. I just wanted to say to Eric, if you want to send me that question, I'm happy to send that to Draghi. You know, with a bunch of MEPs who are here and are interested in that. See if we get a question. We can also raise that question with the Commission, actually. But the point I wanted to raise is a point raised by Mark Burton, who's following us on the live stream, and says there seems to be no ecological perspective at all. Stimulating demand is unselective. And that's also been a concern I've had. I mean, I'm very concerned, only Richard's gone now, but I'm very concerned to hear him wanting to fill up the world with even more people. I mean, people are great, I love you all, but I do think that people bring into with them a demand for resources, and that needs to be acknowledged by economists in general. So I think, you know, making people more skillful and useful is great, but endlessly increasing the number of people is causing a great deal of problem to our planet and its ecological systems. So in terms of stimulating demand through QE, we have to be very careful about this as well. The last time we had loose monetary policy in the European Union, we got an awful lot of roads to nowhere and airports nobody's ever used. Unhelpful infrastructure or infrastructure that further stimulates demand that's energy intensive and actually environmentally destructive. So I think we very much need to find ways of basically we need to undertake a great transition now to a lower energy future, and that's exactly what this kind of money could fund. And as it was funding that, it would create jobs, but it would be useful jobs. So I say that's possible, but the technicalities of organising that, I think, is something we need to think through. How do we ensure, how do we guarantee that an investment is a green investment? How do we make sure that the money is always tied to that green investment? And I'd also like to know from Francis whether there's some possibility of time limiting money, because you talked about bringing that money back. I mean, I've launched a local currency that kind of deteriorated over time and eventually disappeared. But I don't know if that's possible with the kind of money we're talking about here.
In my notes, I had a few extra things that I left out. One of them was the whole question of what we might call picking winners, which is something that governments tend to get criticised for by sort of rabid by right-wingers, saying, oh, government shouldn't be allowed to pick winners. And yet it's not clear to me that the private sector has necessarily been any more efficient or any better or any more and made any better use of planetary resources through being left to pick winners itself. I don't really buy the argument that governments can't make these kind of choices. And it seems to me that actually European governments have a responsibility to pick the right investments. And so I absolutely, completely endorse Molly's point about how do we make sure that if we are using money for investment, that we direct it into forms of investment that are sustainable for the future. It's a reasonable question, and it's something we need to look at. On this question of time-limited money, when I was looking at the whole question of how you, if you wanted to, made sure that any money you did issue as a short-term monetary stimulus to get spent and not saved. One possibility would be to issue it in a form of time-stamped cash, which was a form of money invented by, or proposed originally by an economist called Sylvia Gazelle, where the money simply expires after a period of time, much the same way that a gift voucher does. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm just going to bring in Fabio before we open it up to the floor. So the ECB is independent but bound by European treaties, and some take the view that these treaties are a barrier, although we've heard that it is legal under helicopter money, the citizens' dividend proposal, would be legal. But there is basically the ECB's left in an unclear position. So what are your thoughts on how the European Parliament can work with the ECB to consider some of these alternative monetary policy tools? And any other comments you have on the rest of the debate?
Well, I pretty much agree with what my fellow panelists said. So there's a clear obligation for the ECB to fulfill its price stability target, and they have failed for 4 years in a row. So so I think they have to consider measures. I rarely quote Margaret Thatcher, but I would say in that case there's no alternative to doing that. But if I may just quickly comment on the ecological concern, because I think that's a huge debate for the Green Group especially. I think what we have to get rid of is a certain kind of debate that is focusing on quantitative, pure quantitative debate. Do we need more or less growth? I think it's important to focus on what kind of growth. Just to make an example, if you would finance daycare schools where there would be a free meal to the children, it would be more ecological in many terms, because like individual families would not have to take the car and go to the supermarket and buy groceries. But this would raise GDP because it's a government expenditure. The same goes if you would, you know, like try to finance alternative mobility, and certainly in other sectors you need to degrow. There's no doubt about it. So I think we should focus the debate here. A second remark on the question of the EFSI, because I think this is a very important point that Molly raised. Basically, the argument for the Juncker plan is the following. We have the Stability and Growth Pact. We cannot finance public investment. So what we do now is we provide public guarantees to private investors to do so, mm-hmm. which is in the end even dearer for the taxpayers, because you also have to finance the return on investment for the Deutsche Bank or Allianz, you know, building schools or highways or whatsoever. And the funny thing is that when we raised in Parliament that finance, like EIB investments, are even exempted from the Stability and Growth Pact, in the sense of if you would get a one-off payment to the EIB to, you know, like raise the capital base or whatsoever, it's not falling on the Stability and Growth Pact in most countries. So it would be a much more logical way to circumvent the Stability and Growth Pact if you don't want to abolish it in the short term, or you can't. And so they make up this complicated structure, basically, to the benefit of Deutsche Bank and Allianz and whosoever, instead of going a straight way. And the last comment, because Francis touched upon it, there's always this argument, you know, like governments do not do good allocation decisions. Well, have you ever traveled along the Spanish coast where all these banks made these nice allocation decisions about real estate? So certainly governments can do bad decisions, and there are plenty of examples of that, but especially when you talk about helicopter money, to argue on one hand that individuals make better decisions than government, but then not entrust individuals to make the consumption decisions, is at least not a very coherent economic argument.
Thank you. So I'd like to open it up to the floor, because we've got so many panellists. I'd like to take three questions. So first of all, gentlemen in the grey suit, and if you could keep it brief to the point and introduce yourself, that would be really useful.
Thanks, Fran. Greg Ford from Finance Watch. I have a question for Eric, who's mentioned a couple of times the role of banks in intermediating a citizen's dividend. And the question is this: what role would banks have in making that happen? And how would they benefit? And how would they lose from that?
Do you want to answer that quickly? Yeah, and
I
will.
I mean, we're dealing here with the art of the possible. So I'm not suggesting that using the banks is either necessary nor optimal, but it would be a continuity. The ECB favors continuity, right? Or so an evolution of its policies. And I'm simply observing that if we want to structure this in a way that represents continuity, use an existing program. So you have something called a TLTRO, which the banks are then supposed to on-lend to the real economy. We could effectively extend that to households and change the duration and cost of those loans. So there is no reason why banks would in any way benefit. Presumably there could be an administration fee associated with them, but you could mandate it. The ECB could mandate that they and eligible banks take an LTRO of a certain amount and that it be extended in an equal allocation to EU citizens who show up at a branch. And so all I'm trying to explore is, can we do this in a way that is an evolution of existing policies? But my motivation for that is a practical one. It's neutral to the banks that they would incur administrative costs, but there is no... They are literally your agents in this exercise.
Great, thanks. I will take two more.
Thanks very much. My name is Deirdre de Burke and I work with an international development NGO called World Vision. And the reason I'm here today is because we have spent a lot of time in the development sector, the international development sector, speaking about two new international frameworks that have been agreed last year. One of them is Agenda 2030, or the Sustainable Development Goals. There are 17 internationally agreed development goals where governments, you know, all of the UN member states have signed up to them. They cover issues like economic development, tackling climate change, protecting the environment, investment in health and education services and so on. They break down into very specific targets, and there's also global indicators that have been agreed to track and to measure progress. The problem with the implementation of these goals, which is supposed to happen involving many stakeholders, so the private sector encouraged to get involved along with civil society, academia and many other sectors, the problem is there isn't sufficient finance. In fact, there's a huge deficit in finance, and what governments are telling the development NGOs is that private finance will have to be leveraged for the implementation of this agenda. There's also the COP21, the climate treaty that was agreed in December last year in Paris, and again we need trillions of dollars or of euros to implement that agreement, and again it is unclear where governments are going to get it, and the narrative is around, you know, leveraging private sector finance. So what we are particularly interested in the development sector is to see whether quantitative easing at a global level could help to finance, at least provide public finance to balance, you know, even if we want to leverage private finance, so that there would be some kind of equality or, you know, equal sort of or balance between the amount of private finance and public finance that is being invested in the implementation of these, of this important global, and again, they're quite structured, they're all quite, you know, very clear targets and so on. So the question about would it be good investment or would it be bad, would it be governments investing or would it be private, these are internationally agreed targets, goals, you know, indicators and so on. So that's one question. The other is around the idea of directing money at households. So another thing we have looked at is this idea of a guaranteed basic income, but one that would be globally distributed. And again, it could be linked to the climate treaty. There's a very interesting model called cap and share, which is about setting a global cap on the on the carbon emissions that the global community or the international community will accept, and then the remaining carbon space is basically divided out or allocated to different countries on the basis of their population. And part of the way individual countries distribute that allocation is to give an allocation per head of population to each citizen in the form of a guaranteed basic income. Again, it sounds a little bit, you know, utopian at the moment, but it is entirely doable, again, if the quantitative easing was going to happen at an international level. And the only other last point I'd like to make about the quantitative easing, it's been pointed out the problem of the increased debt burden that would be created if the quantitative easing was debt-based money. So therefore, what some of us in the development sector are thinking of asking for is, we already spoke about this at an event I was at yesterday, a Bretton Woods 2, where it would be possible to actually agree, the international community would come together, international political leaders would come together and agree to issue debt-free public finance into circulation, to use it for some of the purposes I've agreed with, but that it wouldn't create additional debt, because I think to do that would be, as some of the other speakers have said, is just to exacerbate the problem that already exists with the large debt overhang in the global economy. Thank you.
Thank you. I'll take two more questions. The brown jacket.
Thank you. One question about the first objections made by Mrs. Coppola about the mindset of people, because we all have been grown with the common sense that there is no free lunch.
So, could you just introduce yourself?
Yeah, sorry, I'm Antoine Quero, and I work for the Commission, but I've been giving conference about this issue in Spain, and I have often found this objection and the fear about the governance of such a device. Because if we go for sovereign money creation, then we have two types of questions. We have which purpose to serve. We can see that we can serve price stability or to raise inflation through households. We can increase GDP or growth output potential through public investment. We may also serve demography or poverty, anti-poverty plans, etc. There are many purposes we can serve. And then you need also a framework to steer that instrument, how much, for how long, how to revert, or is it exceptional? Is it another instrument in the toolkit of policy, economic policy? So you have two extremes. You have an for governance. You have the stream where you could have populist pressure to serve populist purposes. And you have the other stream, which is a bit, let's say, the ECB, which is purely technocratic, but they don't have the democratic legitimacy to arbitrate between all these different purposes. So we need something in between. What could be this democratic governance framework to pilot such a powerful device?
Thank you. And the gentleman in the grey.
Hello, I'm Frank van Ascot. I work at Fairfin. We're a Belgian-based NGO that works on sustainable banking. And I would like to go a little bit further in the fact that the government is not alone in having the monopoly of misallocating capital. We did a research last year where we looked at the, not only in Belgium, but we also looked at worldwide at how much banks invest in renewable energies and fossil fuels. We said over the last 10 years, and it has barely changed, for every euro that is invested in renewable energy, 9 are invested in fossil fuels. So I think that one of the arguments that we also have to put forward is the urgency. We know that technically and economically it's feasible to have 100% renewable energy in Europe by 2050, but it's like it's as if the start button isn't there. And the mechanism that we have been using since now, which are this, it's emission trading, is not doing the job either. So I think that it could also be a powerful tool of, especially now that we have taken this decision in Paris, that we really wanted to take it serious. It's much better than Copenhagen. So is it okay? How are we going to finance it? And I think that QE can be this form of QE can be interesting for this.
Thank you. So I'd like to take the first and last question kind of together, because it's about QE's role in global problems, so including their sustainable development goals and COP21, and also potentially if anyone wants to pick up on the idea of a global basic income. Who wants to kick off? Eric, would you like to make any comments on that question?
Well, let me make just a very quick point. This is the deflation and insufficient demand is increasingly a global problem. That makes me in one way very optimistic, because there are maybe 20 or 30 countries, different countries, with central banks who have to tackle this problem, which is why one of them might do something very smart. And what will typically happen is they then all copy. Right? So once a citizen's dividend has been done by a country out there, it could be Taiwan. Okay. Taiwan has a deflation problem. Once they do it, and it works, people will copy. That's how human beings and central banks in particular operate. The gentleman from the Commission, I think, raises an incredibly important point, as did Francis, this notion of money for nothing. And I really want to knock it on the head very, very quickly. Every time the ECB changes interest rates, somebody gets money for nothing and somebody gets taxed for nothing. Okay? So that's the immediate answer. Anybody says that to you, this is money for nothing, that happens every time the ECB changes interest rates. Somebody who's borrowed effectively gets a payment for nothing, and somebody who's saving gets taxed for nothing. They haven't changed their behaviors whatsoever. The notion that somebody would change their lifestyle and make bad decisions because if there's a recession, they might get a check from the ECB doesn't really make any sense to how most human beings think. So I really do not buy those as legitimate criticisms. I think with respect to the point about legitimacy, I also think that is very clearly a separate issue. I mean, we can debate the democratic legitimacy of the ECB as it operates, but the ECB already has a very clear legal framework. So I think there's a separate issue, which is, you know, how democratic are the institutions of Europe? But I'm not going to tackle that one right now. But as they stand today, it has a legal obligation to do this. Right? It is fairer than the policies there. It is less contentious than the policies they are currently doing. Negative interest rates is an entirely experimental policy with potentially bizarre effects. There is no empirical evidence that it works. It's never been done on this scale before. Why are they not doing something that has proven empirical evidence, proven effects, is much simpler. Okay, so all of these arguments are out there, but they are very easy to counter-argue.
Thank you. Francis, do you want to come in on both questions again? The global problems and then the democratic framework.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, the democratic question. I was actually quite careful in my reply to separate out supply-side stimulus and demand, because actually that is how we construct our monetary and fiscal framework now, that we tend to regard demand as being the responsibility of the central bank and supply-side reform being the responsibility of the fiscal authority. The current legal structure in the European Union is a one and many structure. So we have a one monetary authority which is responsible for demand across the whole of the Eurozone. And then we have individual fiscal authorities who are responsible for the supply side. That's still a legitimate democratic structure. The problem I think you're highlighting is that in these kind of experimental and unusual monetary responses have considerable fiscal effects, and some of the things we've been discussing are arguably fiscal policy, and so there does need to be some sort of dialogue or some sort of framework for bringing together monetary and fiscal authorities in some kind of dialogue, so they're not doing this kind of game of chicken that they've been doing since about the 1970s. Can I just talk about one other thing as well, which is the lady over there's point about Bretton Woods too, because really, and bringing in Eric's point about deflation being a global problem, and one that isn't going to go away anytime soon, and an increasing need to see cooperation between central banks, rather than this kind of idea that we can somehow all compete our way out of what is a global problem. I don't think we can. I think we do need cooperation. And it may be that we're going to need some kind of council of central banks and some kind of new world monetary framework. We'll have to see where that takes us. And I personally would see possibly some kind of global universal basic income fitting into that. Could be an interesting discussion.
As long as we can have some kind of citizen and democratic insight into that.
Absolutely.
Coalition of new world order, central banks.
Central banks need to be seen for what they are, which is part of the state and responsible to the citizens. Absolutely. For whom they work. They're civil servants.
Thank you, Francis. I'm just going to bring in Fabio. Do you want to?
Just a quick comment on the colleague from the Commission, because I think he raised a legitimate concern in terms of, you know, democratic accountability. ECB is not elected. So my response to that would be certainly that ECB should facilitate, for example, certain investments, while the decisions about these investments should be made on a decentralized level by elected governments. However, ECB would still be free to tighten monetary conditions in the moment where, for example, there's full utilization of capacities, or you would not meet anymore the inflation target. However, and this leads to the question of the negative interest rates. I think, like, now we have even this discourse on terrorist financing, you know, limiting cash, and there's maybe afterthought about that. You could make negative interest rates more effective when you can, prevent that people just hold money under the pillow. But I think it's a very bad idea to force people into consumption. It has not worked in Denmark or wherever it was applied. So for the same reason, I'm also not so much, however, in favor of a basic income. But that's a complete different discussion, because I think, for example, even if we talk about helicopter money, we should focus the resources on liquidity-constrained households, not simply pumping money to, you know, like billionaires or whoever who obviously don't need it, and we should focus on enhancing capacity rather than trying to, you know, like solve distributional issues that belong into the sphere of distribution and not into the remit of central banks. But that's just a very short comment, and I think that would open Pandora's box to discuss here, but just to give you my kind of perspective on that.
Okay, Molly, do you want to quickly?
Yes, I'll try to go through my 5 points very quickly. No, just to say to Eric, I mean, you learn quite quickly when you come here that you start off doing what's possible, and this EIB bond issue being bought by the ECB is just begging to happen. So I think that's why personally I'm focusing on that. In terms of the ECB, I think we definitely need to talk about democratizing. We need to ask who's on the board, you know, because I don't think they have the capacity to make the decisions about what is a green investment. We tried to put that into the report last year. We didn't get a majority for it, I'm afraid. People have mentioned fiscal policy. I should say that myself and Fabio are also on the tax committee here, working very hard to stop corporate tax avoidance, because that's a serious brake on our economy now. Not only is it an injustice, but there's a lot of cash sitting on corporate balance sheets that in a properly taxed world would be reinvested back into the economy. So that is a serious problem in terms of growth, or just, you know, freezing up of the economy, never mind the injustice.
And Paul's also on the tax
committee. Oh, Paul. Sorry, Paul. I've done you an injustice. You don't sit close enough to me, obviously. So on the green, on the point from over here about the investment for the climate transition, this is a really important point, that the agreement made in Paris, there was no agreement about how it would be funded. And part of the reason it was agreed, I believe, is that the private financiers had seen how they could make a profit out of us having to address the issue of climate change. So this is an absolutely crucial question. I did a Huffington Post blog about it at the time called Where There's a Will, There's a Way, because also where there's a will, there's a relative. That's the point. If there's a profit to be made, somebody will be there. And there they were. So, you know, you're absolutely right. What we've agreed at Paris could just make the indebted countries of the world much poorer, and they could be paying Deutsche Bank and everybody else for decades to come. So we have to make sure that that's public investment and QE investment that funds the transition. I just wanted to say as well to Francis that there is a proposal for this international currency. It's Richard Douthwaite proposed the EBQ, and I did some work on that myself about 10 years ago, so I think that's maybe time to resuscitate that now. He was always a little bit ahead of the times, wasn't he?
Paul, it would be great to bring you in on if you've got some comments.
Yes, and let me say that I'm really delighted with this meeting. I also enjoyed it. The question popped in my mind, what would Milton Friedman think? I usually don't have that question, but it occurred to me this afternoon. And he must be abhorred by this meeting, of course, because he's the one who introduced the idea of helicopter money, and we turn it on the upside down, because, of course, he was a proponent of a passive government policy, which is refrained, and we turn it into an active government policy. And hearing the discussion and the questions, this is my experience in as a politician, that we start with one crisis, and then we sort of add the next crisis, the ecological crisis, the employment crisis, the education crisis. And somehow I don't have the feeling that this makes our case more convincing. It just sort of feels the burden comes more, even more heavy. So now we have not only one crisis to solve, but we also have the next, the second and the third crisis to solve. So I would very much like to see where you also, I'm a politician in this respect, where could we get traction? You call it marketing. So where, but I think it's where do we, so I would like to keep us to make this story credible, and I don't think we do that by piling up different problems on top of each other. No, just making my point. you may not agree, but this is my experience. So very much, this is also a very relevant discussion here, because I'm very much deeply concerned about the economic state that Europe is in, and Europe is very good at one thing and muddling through. We're very good at that, but we might get stuck in the mud, really. I mean, that's my concern. So, and I think the credibility of this argument really rests on the case that we are in trouble and get more in even more deep trouble. And then I see indeed that investment is a key, because one reason why I'm pessimistic as an economist, as a politician, is by the lack of investment, meaning that the growth prospect of Europe is hurt. Is harmed, and which makes it more difficult to escape the situation of high private debt and public debt, the problem of security stagnation. And at the same time, I'm not convinced, because what the problem with the FC is, of course, that it's also practical. Do we have a portfolio of ready investments? So we have the productivity effect, which is very attractive. Indeed, we need to get away from investment in fossil energy and towards. But at the same time, if you want to have the spending effect, and that's what we're looking at here as well, so that's the practical point. I have one question also for others. That's on the helicopter money, and of course, that's where I started with Richard Friedman and so on. It's also the distribution effect. You see the distribution effect of current QE is prefers. I think we can agree on that. But do we really need to give this check of 1,500 euro, because it was 1,500, right? Do we send it to everyone? Do I need 1,500? Will it make my difference? That's the question I would look at you. So the way you distribute the money is also an important point.
Very briefly.
Yeah, I mean, those are all great points. Mark Bly, the political economist at Brown University, and I wrote an article in Foreign Affairs suggesting that it should go to people on the lowest 80% of the income distribution. But again, I would go back to the practical point. I think we should just leave that issue. Think about the distribution of utility. 1,500 means a lot more to somebody on a very low income than somebody on high income. So again, I would think not of the financial distribution effects, but the distribution in terms of its utility.
Thank you. Okay, so I think we've got time for one more round of questions. So there's too many hands, but I've seen the first four, so I'm going to go to them. So in the marine shirt. If you can keep your questions very succinct and short, okay. Then we can get through four.
Simon Thorpe, sort of money honnête, which is sort of French positive money. On the question of why we can't, we've had some great ideas, QE isn't working at the moment, there are, Eric's got some great suggestions, why aren't we doing it? I think we can't ignore the fact that the day that a central bank puts debt-free money into people's pockets, we've just pulled the rug under the entire banking system with their effective monopoly on money creation. And I suspect one reason why it's not happening right now is that central bankers like Mario Draghi and Mark Carney are both ex-Goldman Sachs bankers, and I suspect they're not particularly open to a very sensible point of view. And I'm looking at the MEPs. Is there any way we could change the composition of the European Central Bank and get out the Goldman Sachs people, maybe, and put some people who are more interested in a democratic thing?
Okay, so the lady at the back in the black shirt.
Hello, Catherine Fior, EU reporter. I just wanted to ask, I'm not an economic expert, but is monetary policy, is it a second best to fiscal stimulus? That's my first question. And secondly, I'd like to ask the politicians on the panel, how do you think we see that the Commissioner is still holding on to this idea of growth through fiscal austerity, economic growth through fiscal austerity and low interest rates? Do you think that, do we need a deeper recession to make us change our minds and move on? What will it take? Thank you.
And in the grey jacket.
Okay. Yes, I really appreciate all the speakers, but I have to say, I agree.
You can introduce yourself.
Yes, my name is Luca Ciarrocca from Italy. I agree totally with Paul Lang said. So I think it's the issue is political, and for example, the quantitative easing. It's complicated to explain to the general people on marketing, so it's better to say money for the people. And also, I notice, it could be my own attitude, that nobody is really criticizing the banks and the central banks. So, the central banks have commercial banks as shareholders, okay? So the system is unjust. Molly Scott-Cato said, it's an injustice only once So I think the system is very unjust, and that should be actually said very clearly. It's not a question, sorry, but it's for everybody. Thanks.
Thank you. So we're going to take one sentence question or comment. The man in the blue jacket.
All right, one sentence. My name is Sigurd of Petra Pirinkir, the Monetary Reform Association in Iceland. I would like to ask Eric questions. This is a very exciting movement he has regarding TLRO, I thought he said. I would like to hear about, more about that later. But is that what happens to the asset side of the balance sheet of the bank that receives that deposit? Does it entail any financial obligation of the real economy? If not, it's effectively, as I understand, debt-free money creation. And the fact that it's debt-free, what importance does that play in the effects that this citizen dividends will have on the economy as a whole?
Okay, and one more very, very brief comment.
Hi, I'm François Denu, I'm a PhD fellow at the ULB, working on basic income at the European level. My question is to Eric Lonergan. First, why households and not individuals? And second, we have talked about the idea of quantitative easing for the people as a one-shot solution. But what if it's a solution that has to be repeated? Wouldn't it become a kind of UBI? And how do you think of that idea at the European level? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. So we're just going to move across the panel with comments coming from everyone, if that's okay. So I'll just briefly run through the questions. So the last two were for Eric, so you can go last and answer the one on universal basic income and the asset side of the balance sheet and debt-free money. Then the other three were around, this is a political issue, which hopefully the MEPs will address. I'll reframe the first question, which was around orthodox thinking, I guess, in terms of how do you shake up central bank thinking when there's people are populated by the financial sector and there's difficulty into getting these new ideas considered as serious when they're currently considered as radical. And then the second question was around, you know, why is monetary policy better than fiscal policy in terms of a stimulus, and do we need a bigger recession in order to get some bigger change? So I'll let you make a couple of comments each on any one of those questions.
Yeah, let me just make two remarks. Of course, we are in uncharted territory. This is, I couldn't have conceived this 10 years ago. The helicopter money was in my study books, in my textbooks, but of course this was just a theoretical notion. No idea that I would ever discuss this seriously. And to blame, let's say, the central bankers at the ECB, I think they have taken it forward too late, in my opinion. But then again, it's not when you're in uncharted territory, you have to find in this time the consensus, but also the courage to take this step. So we can criticize quantitative easing, or we can criticize FC, but that's not really the point, is it? We have to take steps, and I would rather see that we have to this debate on what works and what doesn't work, because this is where we can find common grounds and we can build consensus, not just on the left side, but also on a broader political spectrum, because I'm a politician in the end, and I want to have to achieve this result. And we don't achieve this result, and I'm very happy with your initiative, we don't receive this result in just one afternoon, so it will be in continuous debate, and I'm happy to have this debate. But my instinct is that to get these new steps in this uncharted territory is that things have to get worse, I'm afraid. So that's to make, I'm afraid, because what you see, of course, governments have the tendency to claim success. Say, well, now if we are doing fine, we are in government, we are doing fine, the economy is doing well. That's a natural tendency. And only if that's that becomes clear that that's not true, then we see a change in policy. So this is also that we have to build pressure as politicians for change, no doubt about it. But I'm afraid that some circumstances may help us in forcing that change.
Well, let me first say that I agree on a few previous comments by Paul on the distribution side of things. And there are various reasons why I also would prefer investment, as investment is key to structural change. So if we're talking about ecological issues involved, for example, also it has a time lag involved. It takes longer, there's no doubt about it. But I would even focus on investment, because I think we cannot let society off the hook to address the distributional issues. I mean, distributional issues are social conflict between labor, capital, and so on. And I don't think we have a magic stick to let that go away.
We wouldn't need politicians, would we?
Yeah, exactly. But I just wanted to quickly address the question on monetary and fiscal policy. Well, there's a very classical answer to that. John Maynard Keynes said you can bring the horses to the water, but you know, you cannot force them to drink, or you can pull the string, but you can't push it. So now we've seen we have ultra-low interest rates, but still no investment. No public investment, because we have put ourselves in a straitjacket of the Stability and Growth Pact. No private investment, because without public investment and with people having, you know, like lower wages and pensions and so on, enterprise won't invest. So somebody has to break that circle, and the answer is certainly that you're overburdening monetary policy, the traditional monetary policy, if you just do monetary policy. So you need a fiscal stimulus, and well, if one way to do it is via monetary policy, so monetizing the stimulus, then I think we should really go for that. A last comment on the question, do we need a further recession? Well, I think we are up for another financial crisis very soon. We all see the issues around Deutsche Bank and so on, and I don't think that a recession will necessarily help the progressive forces, because we see what is happening in Europe currently and the political dynamics. We see that I think we are in the first time a situation where the multiple crises, refugee crisis, economic crisis, and so on, can really lead to breakup of Europe, can lead to breakup of the Eurozone. And I hope we don't need another recession, but one is for sure, that I think we're running out of policy tools, and that's very clear for me.
Thank you. Yes, I actually think there is a possibility for change, because I think the kind of people who are involved in banking and politics are completely aware that the system we've got now is utterly broken. They're constantly trying to restart the growth engine, and they can't find any way to do it. And this is why I think our proposals are very relevant and timely. It takes somebody with the courage to say, I've been wrong all my life, or I see we're in a crisis, I need to do something differently. And currently, I think we don't see sufficient courage on the part of people who are more powerful than we are as politicians to do that. But I do think we're close to that, because it's quite obvious that the policies that are being followed are failing to achieve any of their objectives. Even in their own terms, these policies are failing. And I think there are plenty of people that are aware of that, actually. You know, and to me, this whole aim of trying to restart growth is completely misguided. I mean, I don't want to get into like how you define green growth, but I think it's important to say that a lot of the economy, a vast amount of the economy as it is at present, is complete waste of effort and doesn't achieve anything in terms of social well-being, and most of the banking sector I would put in that category. I won't go much into the whole fiscal versus monetary question, but I do think that from my perspective, we should take that power to create money back from banks entirely, and that's the UK Green Party's policy. So effectively, government then creates money, and it taxes that back in order to maximise investment and keep prices at a stable level. And so that kind of cuts out the bank's role entirely in money creation and restores banks to financial intermediaries, which is actually what most people thought they were, as Richard Werner showed in his slide.
Thanks, Molly. I'm just going to ask our final two speakers to keep it brief.
I'll do my best. as somebody who worked for banks for a long time, I guess I'd better speak about banks, hadn't I? Since there were a few banking questions there. In response to Simon's point there about creation of debt-free money, in fact, that particular horse is already out the stable. Because in actual fact, if you look at how QE was conducted, particularly in the UK, your Bank of England has been creating debt-free money for quite some time. Because it's bought bonds directly from investors rather than going through banks. So we have, in fact, got a proportion of what you might call debt-free money in the system now. You can't distinguish it from any other sort of money. That's the problem. It's completely fungible. You know, one type of money looks much like another, and so actually, it's not quite as radical a change as you might think. It's more a slippery slope, I think. I also think, and I know that, and those of you who've read my work will know that I write about this quite a bit, I think that the banking system as a whole is undergoing major structural change, not only imposed, but actually almost driven by the circumstances in which it finds itself, of which negative interest rates and QE are an important part, because in actual fact, used over the long term, those are disastrous for banks. So we are seeing radical change in the banking sector anyway, willy-nilly. It'll be very interesting to see where that goes. I do feel that you're being a little unfair to central banks. As somebody who works a bit with the Bank of England, I've actually seen a lot of innovation come out of central banks and a real desperate concern to try and find a way of restoring growth and restoring economies in the face of, frankly, totally unhelpful stances from politicians. I have to say that I think it is very unfair to blame central banks for what's going on at the moment. A lot of the responsibility rests at the door of politicians of certain kinds, shall we say. And coming back to the lady's point at the back about monetary policy and fiscal policy, I would say actually over the last, 30 years or so, it's actually been rather regarded the other way around, that monetary policy is where it's at and fiscal policy is something you kind of set up some automatic stabilisers and let them run, and otherwise you don't interfere, basically. And now I think we're beginning to find that that won't do, that in actual fact monetary policy and fiscal policy are equally important. They deal with opposite sides of the economy and they work together in a complementary way. And we've yet to work out exactly how that complementarity works and how it can be framed in a democratic way. And that's part of what the job of the politicians is at the moment.
Okay, let me just deal really quickly with the balance sheet point and the basic sort of permanent basic income point, and then I'd like to say something very briefly about the fiscal monetary policy issue. These are important technical issues, and it goes to Paul's point that we have to convince central banks that it's a sensible policy to do. Actually, at negative interest rates, it's not at all clear whether bank reserves actually don't become an asset rather than a liability because you're receiving income. It's my first point. If you want any more detail, I suppose that probably doesn't mean most to most of you present, and I would sympathize with that, but I can give you a lot of research on this issue. The balance sheet is really not an issue. Key point here is 5% of GDP in transfer payment, in cash transfers to households, is a fraction of what's been done to the balance sheet with QE, right? So actually, if you're worried about the ECB's balance sheet, you have to compare and contrast these policies. Citizens' dividend is a safer policy than doing trillions of QE. With respect to whether it's enduring, we don't know. I mean, the evidence from cash transfers and lots of other economies which have done this as a policy, right? So this is not a policy that hasn't been done before. It's a policy that has been done many, many times in different forms. Are that it has a variable multiplier. In other words, how much it boosts spending by is up for grabs. Personally, I subscribe to a cyclical view of economies which says that they are highly driven by psychology. Now, I would also say to the point about investment spending here, I think there's a cyclical problem in Europe because there is a huge amount of innovation that is available there to be done by the private sector that is not being done. Europe is just being left behind in vast amounts of technological innovation. Having said all of that, Molly's point is entirely appropriate, the quality of the growth, but I would view that as a separate challenge. We can't make the ECB responsible for the quality of the growth, but the quality of the growth has to be legitimately challenged. Personally, I'm not in favor of trying to manipulate demography necessarily because I think we're going to have to live with certain demographic structures. A final point with respect to fiscal and monetary policy, and on an optimistic note, so you should read Ben Bernanke's, I think it's called The Courage to Act. It's a surprisingly interesting read. That may reflect my rather dull reading taste, but I highly recommend it. There's one fascinating moment in it which should give us all both a modicum of concern as believers in democracy, but also some optimism. He's asked by Barney Frank when he is rescuing AIG, and this is, you know, the fourth rescue, tens of billions of dollars, and a light goes up. Barney Frank was one of the most important congressmen in recent U.S. economic history, designer of Dodd-Frank, the financial regulation, so hugely important politician. He suddenly says, where are you getting the money from? And Bernanke obviously realizes that Barney Frank doesn't realize he can just print it. That Ben Bernanke, with a few other guys, can just and members of the FOMC, can get into a room and decide effectively in the public interest to distribute tens, if not hundreds of billions of dollars. Barney Frank is a career politician. He has, that is an extraordinary power, and he's not even aware that the central bank has that power. Now, very interestingly, Bernanke doesn't even answer him directly. He doesn't tell him the truth, because I think he's rather terrified that he'd be permitted to have that power. Now, here's the thing. Mario Draghi has actually been making amazing decisions, very brave decisions, very, very controversial political decisions. I do not think it is a huge move for them to go to saying we will make TLTROs to individuals or to households. And I particularly don't think it's a big move if another central bank has done it. Okay. Now, finally, it's a good policy. To that extent, is it legitimate? Will it have democratic legitimacy? It'll probably have been the best thing that people will have seen from the Eurozone for a very long period of time.
Thank you. Okay, so... Phew! We made it to the end. I just want to briefly summarise because we've had such amazing speakers and discussion. We heard from Frédéric at the beginning how the existing QE is fueling speculation. Richard talked about how the money supply is created by the banking sector. Most people don't know this, and Eric re-emphasised the fact that most politicians don't know that, and that's a bit of a problem. If we don't know how money's created, then how can we get out of this crisis? Francis brought up a really important point around the kind of taboo around giving people money for nothing and the need to change thinking around that. Eric also raised the important point of there's no evidence that negative interest rates are going to work. We know that cash transfers to citizens do. Paul slightly pessimistically said things are going to have to get worse before they get better. And Fabio really eloquently highlighted that one way of doing a fiscal stimulus that's needed is via monetary policy. And Molly emphasised that these proposals are relevant and timely and we need to consider them now. So I think you'll all agree that the panellists have been fantastic. So I just want to thank you and yourselves for coming here and the panellists and the supporting MEPs for making it happen. And please join us in Members Salon 4, for a drink, and to do that you need to go down the stairs to the ground floor and you should be able to see our poster to the left. So if you join me in a round of applause, thank yourselves and the panelists and the organisers for coming along to this great event.